Bun găsit, prieteni! Alături de noi astăzi este Michael Ramsden, apologet, evanghelist, director internațional al misiunii Revi Zacharias. Welcome, Michael Ramsden.
Thank you.
And thank you for the time you've given us.
You're very welcome.
Because you have an interesting job, and we'd like to know more about it. You said your job is to answer people's questions about Christian faith. Can you? I can't think of anything more difficult right now. How do you feel having this job?
Actually, I love my job. So at times it is very challenging. But the way I myself became a Christian was by a group of Christians who I got to know. I met with them every week. I was filled with millions of questions, and very slowly, very patiently, they talked to me, and I began learning more and more. It's not about having an exhaustive answer to every question, but it is about having a meaningful one. And what I began to realize was many of my questions had meaningful answers. So if you think about it, if Jesus Christ has nothing meaningful to say about death, suffering, injustice, I mean, all the biggest problems we face, that would be strange if he were God. That means he has nothing to say, no opinion on this issue, no insight greater than our own. And what I began to realize was he had much greater insight. It was amazing to me. The problem I then had was, after about 9 months, I thought, oh no, it's true. And then I didn't want it to be true. I suddenly realized that if it were true, it would change my life. And I was so happy with my life, I didn't want it to change. And that then was my problem. So after I became a Christian, I thought, they gave me the opportunity to ask my questions. I would like to give other people the opportunity to ask me. And as in Europe and across the world, sometimes tensions have grown, especially some forms of religious tensions. Either we fight about those things or we talk about them. And my body isn't built for fighting. So I prefer talking. And what I've discovered is if you're willing to allow people to ask their questions and you're willing to engage with them, then it's possible to talk with people, and you get a great joy of seeing other people respond. And even with young people, I remember the last time I spoke at a big youth conference, I said, why don't I not give a talk? Ask everyone to write questions. I'll draw them at random. Whatever question I pick, I'll face it. And on day one, I can't remember how many people we had, but on day two, we had 5 times as many on day one. On day three, we had 3 times as many on day two. So 15 times as many as day one.
And you think it's because you let them ask?
And I think the answer was saying, look, it's okay. If this is true and real, I may not be able to answer all of your questions completely, but I think there are meaningful answers to all of these things. And if it's true, no matter how you come at it, it should be the same. We're scared of questions when we're lying. That's when we don't like being asked lots of different questions.
But maybe we don't know the answers, and that's why we are scared.
And sometimes the answer is, I don't know. That's correct. But sometimes there are deeper answers there, but we haven't always taken the time to think what they may be. Or maybe they haven't been. So I had people teaching me and helping me. In the same way I now try and help other people, and I'm still learning every day. And that's what is thrilling for me, is to see that. And certainly in universities like, you know, Dartmouth or Cornell or Oxford or Hong Kong University, or with when I was speaking with the European Parliament, or, you know, in NATO or wherever it may be, there are people there, and they have questions. And allowing them to be able to ask those questions and discover for themselves if there are any answers is very joyful. And it's a great joy to see people responding to Christ as they go through that process.
You say that every Christian should be an apologist, but then what's the difference between you? Yeah. You already said that you studied, yeah, and you are still, yeah, studying about this, yeah, and any, yeah, Christian.
Yeah. Well, so, at the most basic level, an apologist is answering the question, why? Why are you a Christian? Now, many Christians, when they're asked that question, why, they say how they became a Christian. Well, I was born in this family, I went to this meeting.
Or something happened to me.
Yeah, something happened to me.
Good or bad.
Yes, good or bad. But that's a different question. Why you are a Christian and how you became, mm-hmm, both important questions, but different. So if Christians tell non-Christians
how?
How to the non-Christian, it sounds like brainwashing. It sounds like someone fooled you, and it sounds like chance. What happens if you met a Buddhist or a Muslim that day? You'd be a Buddhist, right? So the how we became a Christian is a wonderful and important part, but it still doesn't answer the question, why? And so what the Bible seems to assume is when someone asks you, why are you a Christian? You need to be ready to say, well, this is why. And many Christians find themselves
not ready.
Not ready. And that's sometimes.
Is that a sin?
Yeah, I think it's sometimes we've been told what to believe, but no one ever explained why to us.
Oh, so that's why it is important to ask questions.
Yes. The thing that amazed me after I became a Christian, when I was living in the Middle East, I used to listen to BBC World Service Radio, which is why I have the accent I do, because it sounds like BBC World Service. And they would interview lots of world leaders. And they would always ask them really good questions. You know, Mr. President, Mr. Prime Minister, what do you think about all these different world leaders? And the world leaders would always answer a different question. So the interviewer would ask a very good question. The leader would ask a different question. And it used to make me really mad. I'm sure this doesn't happen in Romania. I'm sure Romania is different.
Yeah, they gave straight answers.
And they would say, but you haven't answered my question. They'd ask it again. And then they'd answer another question, still not asked. And I remember I'd been a Christian for 2 days and I'd read through the Gospels twice, all four Gospels. And it seemed a lot of people came to Jesus and they would ask a question. And then he would seem to answer another question. And I was a Christian, I was a two-day-old Christian, and I was thinking,
not fair.
Is Jesus a politician? Huh. Oh no, this is terrible. Well, after more than 20 years of studying the Gospels, actually coming up for 30 years now, I realized he never avoided any difficult question. What he normally did is he responded with a question of his own.
Why?
Because the person, if you're asking the wrong question, even if you give the right answer, your answer will always be considered to be wrong. Giving the right answer to the wrong question is always wrong. So 9 times out of 10, the questions that Jesus has been asked are the wrong ones. And so they will ask a question, and then when he comes back with a question of his own, and it's geared to make them think. So I can give you a good example. Jesus is asked the question, by whose authority are you doing these things? Luke chapter 20. Jesus says, okay, I will answer your question if you will answer mine. John the Baptist. Where did he get his authority from? Now, the people asking the question are a group of religious leaders. They all go aside.
Actually, it's a trap.
And they talk and they say, ooh, if we say John the Baptist had authority from heaven, the people will say, why didn't you believe him? Because they rejected him. Then they say, but if we say his authority was given by men, the people will reject us because they believe it came from heaven. So the problem is they think John the Baptist only had authority from men, but they're not prepared to say it because they're scared of the crowd. So they turn to Jesus and they say, we don't know. Now, interestingly, Jesus doesn't say, huh, I don't know either. That's not what he says. He's not playing games with them. He says, you will not answer me. I will not answer you.
That was the deal.
So in other words, he was saying to them, you are not prepared to be honest with your own question. If you were prepared to be honest and say what you thought, then I would answer your question too. But you're not prepared to be honest with me. And this question about are we willing to be honest with our questions, the reason why Jesus asked so many questions was that it's not just the question, there's also the questioner. There's the person, the heart behind it. And Jesus is saying to them, I'm not interested in playing games with you. Okay? So, and the question is designed to actually help them. If they're prepared to be honest, he can help them. If they're not prepared to be honest and listen, no amount of speaking will make any difference.
How important honesty is in this relationship or the beginning of a relationship with God?
If you think about it, honesty is important to every relationship. Your friends are people who you feel you can trust. If you found your friends were lying to you, they're not your friends. We are betrayed when the people we love betray us and we are hurt and they cease, the relationship we have is gone. So relationship with God has to be built on honesty. And I think many Christians struggle with that. So actually I was speaking with a girl just now. She said, I'm having a very difficult time and actually to be honest, I'm quite angry with God right now. And I said, are you familiar with the story of Job in the Bible? She said, yeah. I said, do you remember in chapter 1, God says Job is the most righteous person on the planet? In other words, God says about Job. Job doesn't say it about himself. Job is closer to me than anyone else. And then all those bad things happen to Job. And Job brings his complaint before God. God, you don't care. Where is justice? What has gone wrong? When you get to the end of the book of Job, God says to Job, Job, in all you have done, you have not sinned. Now that's amazing. How can it not be a sin to say the kinds of things to God that Job said to God? And the reason is, you have to be honest in your relationship with God. If you're doubting God, you can't come to pray before him and say, God, I trust you. That's not true. If you feel that God has let you down, you can't come and say, God, you're always faithful. That's not true. That's not how you feel. You can come before God and say, God, I feel I've been let down by you. I feel you're not here right now. And we see that in the Psalms, we see it in Job, we see it all the way through. Honesty before God. Now, God doesn't want us to stop there. Does that make sense? He doesn't want us to stop there. He would like us to come back into that place of knowing him. When Job finishes his complaint, God asks Job 64 questions back to back. And after Job has heard God's 64 questions, he says, wow, some of this is very difficult. There are many things I don't understand, and yet I trust. And he comes back into relationship with God. Then Job says something even more amazing. Remember in chapter 1, God said of Job, you're the most righteous man on the planet. No one, they're the closest in terms of relationship. In Job chapter 42, verse 5, Job compares the relationship he has now, after all of this questioning, with the relationship he had before. Mm-hmm. And he says, in the past, I had heard of you with my ears, but now I have seen you with my eyes. He says the contrast in intimacy between where I was and where I am now is the difference between hearing and seeing. I am now much closer to you
than before. Because of this honesty.
So God isn't, so I think one of the things we have to help Christians with is it's okay to have questions. It's okay to come before God and say, this is how I feel, because that's how you feel. You don't feel.
So doubt is also important.
So you take John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist, remember, he baptizes Jesus. And when Jesus is baptized, the voice from heaven says, this is my son whom I love.
Right.
Okay, listen to him, right? And John the Baptist sees the dove falling, you know, the Holy Spirit onto Jesus.
And still.
Wow. Then he's in prison, right?
Right.
He's suffering. He has doubts. So he sends his disciples to say, are you the one we're expecting or is someone else coming? Now, if I were Jesus, I would say to them, are you serious?
Do you remember
what happened? But Job's doubt is sincere. And Jesus looks and he says, go tell John. The blind can see, the lame can walk. Okay, the captives are set free.
Oh, he doesn't even say, yes, I am.
Yeah, and blessed is the person who's not offended because of me. Do you remember? And they go back to reassure, because that's what John needs now, John the Baptist. He needs reassurance. And Jesus gives that reassurance. He doesn't tell him off. So there's that kind of doubt. That is an honest, real, and Jesus deals. Now, let's take a different type of doubt. After the resurrection, do you remember? Two disciples are walking along. Jesus joins them. They don't recognize him. Jesus says, why are you so sad? They say, are you the only one who doesn't know? And Jesus, now the funny thing is, he's the only one who does know. He says, well, what happened? And they said, have you not heard about Jesus of Nazareth? We thought he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed. You know, and they crucified him. What is more, his body has disappeared. And Jesus rebukes them. He says, you idiots. Did you not know this had to happen? Now, here's the question. Was Jesus being fair? And the answer must be. He must be being fair. So if he told them off, he must have been legitimate in his rebuking them. And he was saying, look, you've heard this many times. This is explained. And starting with Moses and the prophets, he explains all the way through. You know, and then they suddenly get it. But there, he is responding to a doubt born out of ignorance. They should know something which they don't know. So that's the second type of doubt born out of ignorance. But in that case, they should have known. Now, there's a third type as well.
The evil one.
I mean, there are so many. Well, it's the difference between, you know, in the Bible where Mary is pregnant and she says, "How can it be? I'm a virgin." And the angel says, "Well, the power of God will overshadow you," and so on. And she's given this answer. Do you remember it? When the angel appeared to Zechariah earlier, and he says to Zechariah, "Hey, your wife is going to have a baby," he says, "How is that possible? I'm an old man, my wife is an old woman, how is that possible?" And the angel strikes him dumb.
But it's the same question.
Yes, it's the same question. So is it fair? Why is it that the angel strikes Zechariah dumb, but Mary is given an answer? Is it, you know, the angel got told off, you know, after the first one, "Don't do that again," so he's different with Mary? I don't think that's what's going on. Zechariah, we're told, wanted a baby. And he and his wife had been praying for a child for decades, and they hadn't had one. That's very painful. They're crying and they're praying and they're praying. And then an angel comes to Zechariah and says, "God has heard your prayer, and you will have a baby."
And still he says,
I don't believe it. Mary was not praying for a virgin birth. Okay, Mary was not only saying, "Hey, I'd love to have a virgin birth, I think it's a great idea." All right? So the difference between the two is Zechariah's doubt is very different to Mary's. Zechariah was asking God for something, serving God, he was being paid by the temple, and he didn't actually believe. He was going through the motions. And when the angel appears and tells him, and he doesn't believe, of course it's very serious. For Mary, it's very different.
But do tell us that even for this kind of doubt, God has mercy.
Yes, so here's the reason why I like the story, is when John the Baptist is born, Zechariah's mouth is opened, and the first thing he does is he praises God. You know, he will be called John, do you remember? He nods his head, and then his mouth is opened, and actually God is able to deal even with that hardness of heart that he had had. So there can be a cynicism in doubt. Cynical doubt is when, not that you're struggling to believe the answer, that's what Mary had. Cynical doubt is, because of my doubt, there is no answer. That's the doubt that Pilate had when he said, "What is truth?" and just walked away. He didn't stay for the answer. And that's a very dangerous form of doubt. That's when we use our doubts to feed cynicism and we become hard. And even if an angel were to appear to us and say, "By the way, I can tell you what you were praying last night, it was this," you know, we still wouldn't believe it. Now that's a really dangerous place to be.
So it's not all about answers, questions and answers, but about heart too.
It's about our heart. The heart is very, very important. Now, interestingly, Mary's objection to the virgin birth is scientific. That she has a scientific doubt. "I'm a virgin." So she's saying, "Look, I know how babies are made.
So it can't be."
And so it can't be true. It's a scientific objection. And she is given an answer to deal with her scientific objection, which is very interesting. So God doesn't have any problems with her biological argument against the virgin birth, because that's perfectly normal. So it has to be answered. And so I think there are answers to some of those kinds of issues that we can give.
The hardest questions you have ever been asked as an apologist?
The hardest question will always be, why has this happened to me? Because that's a very difficult question to answer. And so just very quickly, we sometimes attempt to say, "Oh, this is happening to you because you did something bad." Well, that might be true. If I get drunk and I reverse over your best friend and kill them, there's a direct line between my sin and their death. But it doesn't always look like that. Sometimes there are no direct, obvious lines. Why was this man born blind? Did he sin or his parents? And the answer is neither. There is no direct line between someone doing something wrong and the situation they're in. So when someone says, "Why me?" they're assuming that there's always a direct line. Does that make sense? This happened last year or 10 years ago or whenever, and that explains why. Well, that might be true, but very often it's not true. How do I know how to answer it? That's the problem.
And what do you do then? The last
resort is to say, "Can I pray for you and pray for you?" And I will pray with them. And I'll pray two things. One, that they'll have some peace and we'll find a resolution to their question. And secondly, I'll say, "Lord, is there something that you would have me say to them that will help them with this?"
So it's about relationship,
yes,
after all.
Yes, it is.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.